Hello, we are the First United Methodist Church of Normal, Illinois. Welcome to worship. Journey toward Easter. And after this year, which after all has been a year for many of us of confusion, of disease, of even death, of isolation, and for some of despair, we are on a journey to hope. We are proclaiming that we are on the journey toward Easter and that God is doing new things in our midst. We are saying together today that as we journey toward Easter, we're looking forward to looking out on the death valleys of our life and seeing life blooming in its fullness as God plants seeds of resurrection. So the question for us today is, how do you and I find hope? How do we see these seeds of resurrection? Do you feel hope today? Do you need hope today? How do we look out and see what God is doing? How do we learn to read the signs, to find God's guidance, to let God guide us in our footsteps? And how do we get to the place where we know the life God has in store for us? Not a simple or easy life, but a life that is hopeful, a life of love and grace. We're going to talk together today about those signs and how to read the signs in order to make our way toward Easter. I'm glad you're here to be part of this. Let's worship God together.
Thank you. The Call to Worship. Hear these words from Bishop Desmond Tutu. God created order out of disorder, cosmos out of chaos, and God can do so always, can do so now, in our personal lives and in our lives as nations globally. The most unlikely person, the most improbable situation, these are all transfigurable. They can be turned into their glorious opposites. Indeed, God is transforming the world now, through us, because God loves us. That is why we're here. That is why we worship.
Amen.
Join us in Be Thou My Vision. It's a new month. That means we've got a new life app. I think that March is all about patience. Of sugar, 2 tablespoons of butter, okay, some vanilla. I think I've got that. Oh, hey, everyone! I'm so excited you could join us as we explore some culinary creations and some edible experiments. That's right, we're having a bake-off. We're taking on some tasty challenges as we find out what it means to have patience. Now, patience is waiting until later for what you want right now. And I know that can be so hard to wait for something when you want it right now. That's why you got to sprinkle in some patience, especially when you bake. Raise your hand if you've ever baked anything before. Yeah. Do you just dump a bunch of ingredients in a bowl and hope it comes out right? No, you have to take your time and be patient and measure things out so that it will come out just perfect. Well, I don't know how many times that I have dumped in either too much salt or not enough flour, and it just didn't turn out right. We have to have patience in a lot of things, especially baking. Now, today's Bible story is about a man who really showed us what it means to have patience. And there's tons of characters in the Bible that teach us things, like David defeated the giant, and Esther was so brave and courageous and rescued her people. But this particular character really teaches us about patience. And his name is Simeon. Simeon taught us what it really means to have patience. Hi, I'm Simeon. Hi. Hi, I lived in Jerusalem, and you can read about me more in the book of Luke. But one thing it did say was that I was a good and godly man. That means that I followed God and that I lived the way God wanted me to. I knew the scriptures really well, and I knew about a promise that God had made about sending a savior. I was really familiar with these words from Isaiah 9:2. The people who are now living in darkness will see a great light. They are now living in a very dark land, but a light will shine on them. I waited patiently for God's promise to come true, and I believed that that great light coming was the Savior, the one that would rescue us. In fact, the Holy Spirit even told me that I would not die until I saw the Savior. Now, the Bible doesn't really say how long that I waited, but I will tell you that I waited for years and years and years and years. It was a long, long time. One day the Spirit just led me to go to the temple courtyard. And so I went to the temple, and do you guess who I saw there? Yeah, I saw Mary and Joseph. I saw a young couple holding a baby. And I knew, because according to God's law, Mary and Joseph were going to bring baby Jesus to the temple. I knew that was the Savior. Oh my gosh. And so I ran over there, and I was so excited. I was leaping for joy and praising God. And I asked to hold baby Jesus, and I did. And I said, Lord, you are the King over all. Now let me, your servant, go in peace. That is what you promised. My eyes have seen your salvation. You have prepared it in the sights of all nations. God kept his word. He kept his word to me, that I would see a Savior before I died. Before I left, I made sure to bless Mary and Joseph and the baby. I knew it'd be a hard job, but I waited. I was so patient, and I got to see the promise. It was so cool. Simeon must have really trusted God a lot to be that patient. He waited a long time to see God's promise. And sure enough, God came through. No matter what you wait for, God is always with you. You can trust God while you're waiting, just like Simeon did. You can trust God no matter what. You can trust God when you have to wait for something little, like when your grandma says, you can't have a snack before dinner. You can trust God when you're waiting for something big, like your new baby sister or to be born, or maybe your mom or dad to find a job. God will always be with you. So our bottom line this week, kids, is when you have to wait, remember, God is with you. I wonder what it must have been like for Simeon to wait so long. I mean, the Spirit had promised that he would see a Savior. Simeon had no idea when that would happen. It might have taken years and years. And it did, but Simeon waited patiently, and God was there the whole time. There are times when we have to wait too, and it's not hard. So remember, when you have to wait, God is with you. That's right. To think about it, it's been a really hard year, you guys, kids, with this pandemic, and we just wanted things to go back to somewhat normal, and there were times where it seemed like that might never, ever happen. God is with us. God has been with us this whole time. God is with us right now. And God will give us the strength that we need when we have to wait. Our memory verse, kids, wait for the Lord. Be strong and don't lose hope. Wait for the Lord. That's Psalm 27:14. Remember, God is always there with you, even when you have to wait. Have a great day. Bye.
The scripture reading for today is the lesson of the fig tree from Luke chapter 21, verses 29 through 31. And he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they come out in leaf, you see for yourselves and know that the summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near.
In Luke's gospel and in other places in the Bible, Jesus says to us, you must be able to read the signs. You need to be able to read the signs. What is Jesus saying here? What does Jesus mean? Well, some people, when they read these scriptures, they focus only on the end times, the time when Jesus will come back and there'll be a day of judgment. I think it's at least as important, if not more so, to focus on what Jesus is saying about reading the times of the coming of the kingdom of God here and now. To be able to read the signs and know what God is up to right now. To be able to see the signs of what God wants from my life and from your life. What God is doing in our midst and what God is calling us to do. That's largely what it means to me, to be able to read the signs. To see the seeds of what God is up to, the seeds of resurrection. I believe that God is providing you guidance, and God is showing you things. The question is, do you know how to read and to see what God is doing and what God is showing you so that you can participate? So to get some help with thinking about how to read the signs, I thought, how do we learn to read the signs? And I thought of two groups of people. I thought of sailors. Jesus mentions, people sailing. How do sailors, it's pretty important to them to be able to read the weather and to know what's coming so they can know what they're sailing into. But I don't know any sailors. So another group I thought of that Jesus often mentions in the Bible is farmers. Farmers, it's important for them to be able to read the signs and to know when to plant and when to harvest. So I went out and interviewed a couple of real life farmers, Jeff and Brian Fuller, and I asked them, I said, how do you know? What signs do you look for? How do you know when to plant and when to harvest? And here are a few things they told me. For planting, for example, they said the temperature in the soil needs to be right, around 56 degrees, if I remember right. The soil shouldn't be too wet or too dry. I like this. They said, we want happy seeds. Happy seeds. I like thinking about happy seeds. They said the first 48 hours is critical when the seeds are planted. So we want to watch out and make sure no cold rain is coming so the seeds don't get seed injury. They said we want consistency, consistent temperatures, no beating rains. For harvest, they said it needs to be dry enough before we harvest. It seems that Amy gets a little upset when they have to pay too much for drying the corn or the beans. They said we want to make sure the corn is mature. So they go out and look at the corn and make sure it's at the right place. The moisture, they said, can be around 35%, but we really want it under 25 to 22% moisture. The soybeans, I also want dry, 13% moisture. And what Jeff said is after Labor Day, with the beans, they go out and they hand shell them and mark them. They measure kind of where they are. Then they go back a week later and measure that and judge it and decide when it's the right time to harvest. The whole time they're watching for disease and damage. So this is what my simple mind took away from what I understood with this conversation with our farmers. They have to be able to read the weather. They have to anticipate how the winds will blow, what the rain will be like, how warm it will be. They have to understand the soil, and they have to measure the soil. They have to be willing to go out and get their hands dirty to dig in the soil. They have to go out before harvest and to be willing to walk out into the field and to pick some of the corn and to tear that back and look and see what the corn is doing and see if it's mature. They predict what will happen based on years, seasons of learning to listen to nature and learning from success and from failure. I have a feeling these farmers also talk to other farmers, so they don't have to learn every mistake on their own. They can also learn from the mistakes of others. And then in the end, I think most farmers will tell you they have to live with some faith that there are things they can't control. So how would you apply this wisdom to your own field and your own life? Now, let me say a quick word about prophecy in general, and then we can talk about reading God's signs in your own life personally. Then we'll be done. You know, when I was growing up, I got the wrong idea. I thought that the job of a prophet, God's prophet, was to predict the future. And when you read the Bible, sometimes the prophets do talk about something that's going to come true in the future. But as I learned more about the Bible, the real role of God's prophet, it's not looking into a crystal ball, you know, in some entertaining way to tell us the future. The real job of a prophet is to bring us a message from God. And often that message is a warning that we're getting off the path, that we're not close to God, that we need to correct our walking, correct our steps so that we will walk closer to God. That's the role of a prophet. Now, I don't know if you've heard about this. Evidently, there's some turmoil in the Pentecostal movement right now, our Pentecostal brothers and sisters, and especially among those who consider themselves Pentecostal prophets. And here's what the controversy is about. These prophets, some of them, have prophesied that Donald Trump would be reelected as president. And then after the election, some of them prophesied that Donald Trump would stay in office as president, even though the election didn't look like he won. So now we're the controversy is, some of these Pentecostal prophets are saying, we were wrong. We got it wrong. We need to get closer to God. We need to repent and figure out why we got it wrong. But other Pentecostal prophets are not admitting they got it wrong. They're doubling down. And they're saying, well, we got a few of the details mixed up, but Donald Trump is going to come back as president. And some are saying it's going to happen in March, and some are saying it's going to happen in April. So now you've got these Pentecostal prophets arguing with each other about what God's will is and what's going to happen. It reminds me of some of the claims that you get from other prophets through the years. You know, it seems like almost every couple of years, there's somebody who stands up and says they're a prophet and the world's going to end. And sometimes they go up a mountain and, you know, and wait for the end of the world and it doesn't come. And then they have to deal with that. When these Pentecostal prophets think about the divisions, they have to decide how they're going to respond to getting it wrong. What did Jesus say? Jesus warns explicitly in Scripture that there will be many false prophets and many false prophecies that will come along. So for you and me, how do we tell the difference between someone who is mentally ill or someone who is just telling you what they want to believe to be true and calling it God's word? And how do we tell what's a true, authentic, prophetic word from our God? How do you and I read the signs? Well, what does Jesus say? Jesus says, you will know them by their fruits. What does this mean? Well, I think one of the things it means is that people who are financially profiting or are doing well financially in a personal way through their prophecy, that may be a sign that they're not God's true prophet. You know, those people selling miraculous water on TV or whatever it is they're selling. Prophets getting rich off of God are probably not God's true prophets. God's true prophets are people who look like Jesus, who follow Jesus, who do the things that Jesus instructs us to do in the Bible. So let's get more personal for a minute. How do you read the signs of your own life? How do you know what is God's word for you? What guidance is God offering you, and how do you read that and see it? What are the signs? What is God wanting you to do? Because I think there is a real danger of us just doing what everyone else around us is doing and thinking that's God's will. And sometimes that's absolutely not the right thing to do. Or there's a danger of just following in the patterns of our past, kind of continuing in routines and continuing in the direction we have been going, when God really is calling us to turn and go in a different direction. There's a danger of missing out on the authentic life and love and grace that God has for us. So how do you learn to read the signs? Well, just like the farmer who learns from the season, we do need to learn how to read the signs. And I think we do this, number one, by learning who Jesus is, by really focusing on the identity of Jesus. What did Jesus teach us? What does Jesus say? What does Jesus do? What did Jesus tell us that we are to do? And we can measure the things that come along by looking through the lens of Jesus and saying, does this fit with what I know about Jesus and who Jesus is? Number two, we need to learn to read the Bible in deep ways in order to see the signs. You know, many of us think we know how to read the Bible, but maybe we're just kind of carrying on the reading that we learned to do as children. And maybe we've never gone deeper to really understand what the Bible is and how the Bible works and what the Bible is really telling us. Many of us need to learn to read the Bible in a deeper way. Number three, we need to learn to pray deeply to God. And that involves listening to God and not just talking. You know, it is amazing when we ask God, God, show me the signs, open me. That often happens. When we are open to God, God delivers. Number four, we need to understand the wisdom of our tradition that comes to us as millions of people who went before us worked on these same thorny problems that many of us face, and the meaning of life and who God is. Our tradition has a lot to teach us and can direct us towards seeing God and to seeing God's signs. And number five, we need to learn from our own experiences, just like the farmer who has season after season of going out and chucking the corn and seeing what it looks like. We need to learn from our own experiences which actions really lead us closer to God and which lead us farther away. What have we learned from our mistakes and our successes? What can you do to be able to read the signs this season? What will help you to be guided so that when we get to Easter, you'll be ready to look out and you can see the seeds have been planted and life is blooming for you? May we all learn to read the signs. Amen.
Please pray with me. Holy One, we shudder at the signs we see, and anxieties bombard us. Our hearts are afraid. God, let us be vigilant, holding our heads high. Make us an Easter people with hope as our stronghold. Jesus, you once came into our world with all its sorrows. Keep us awake and alert to your presence in the midst of our struggles now. Remind us again that your love will triumph. And now let us join together praying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So we prepare to join together in Holy Communion. I invite you to pause here if you need to do so to gather bread or crackers, juice or water, whatever it is that you have on hand, and then to come together and participate in this special meal with us. Jesus shared meals in all kinds of homes. He ate with Zacchaeus, who was a collaborator and a crook. He ate with Simon the Pharisee, where he defended the woman who caused a scene at a dinner party. And he also ate in the home of Martha and Mary and Lazarus. Those were his friends, and that was a house where he could laugh and relax and have fun. We're used to sharing this meal together in grander buildings, in spaces that are set apart as sacred. But the home is where it all began. An ordinary home in upstairs rooms or wayside inns around kitchen tables. Is in the spaces where people live, surrounded by the ordinary clutter of living. And so today we pray, come, Lord Jesus, be our guest here in our homes. Come, Lord Jesus, be our host here at your table. Amen. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to God. Let us give thanks to the source of life. We bring our thankful praise. We praise and thank you, Eternal One, love that will not be contained. For you created the earth, its grandeur, its detail, its delicate balance. And you created us, people, to tend and protect and delight in it. And when we forgot our beginnings and neglected our purpose and lost our way, you sent prophets to call us back and laws to illumine our path. And finally, you came yourself to show us how to live and to demonstrate the magnitude of your love for us. Love that will not be contained. Love that will not give up on us. Love that will journey into the darkest places, even the grave, to find us. And so we lift our voices to join with nature's song and the great chorus of witnesses on earth and in heaven. Holy, 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 love that will not be contained. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Let's hear again the story of Jesus' supper with his disciples on the night before he died. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing the bread, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body." And then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of a new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." And so we pray, come Holy Spirit, pour out your blessing on our bread and wine and on us, your gathered people. We don't need an altar, a silver chalice, or a starched table linen. It's your presence that makes these things, these ordinary things, holy. Here is the bread, broken as the body of Christ was broken, broken as the heart of God was broken, broken as the seal of the tomb was broken, broken to make us whole. The body of Christ broken for us. And here is the cup, a cup that brings us together, even in our social distancing, a cup of forgiveness and blessing, the love of Christ poured out for us. We take and drink. Please pray with me. Thank you for the grace that makes space for us at your table. Thank you for the familiar and beloved faces on our screens. Thank you for the closeness we experience through technology and through sharing this meal together. May we continue our lives having been nourished and strengthened, filled with your uncontainable love that spills over to bless the world. Amen.
Let's sing "Faith While Trees Are Still in Blossom."
Plant the picking of the fruit.
I have hope because I believe that even now, God is planting the seeds of resurrection for our broken world. May we learn to read the signs, to see what God is doing, so that we can put our own lives in the flow of God's calling and God's blessing. Hope you have a good week. God bless you. Hope to see you soon. Amen.